So when you come in to the oratory, normally you'd approach from the Hagley Road, busy main road, which still, of course, thunders with traffic in and out of Birmingham at all hours of the day and night. And many people who walk along the Hagley Road in the midst of all this noise and turn off unexpectedly where they see the blue plaque commemorating John Henry Newman, founder of the English Oratory, suddenly find themselves, to their amazement and delight, in this very quiet courtyard with its beautiful arches and the fascinating memorial tablets, all in Latin, of course, on the wall by their side as they approach the magnificent church which suddenly appears before them.
We have deliberately set ourselves down in a populous district and have commenced, as St. Philip did, by ministering chiefly to the poor and lowly. For the work of the oratory is a tranquil work and requires peace and security to do it well. You should do a good deal of hard work in your generation and send many souls to heaven.
Welcome to the Church of the Birmingham Oratory. I'm Father Guy Nichols, and I'm the parish priest here and the assistant superior. This church, which you can see here, was built slightly less than 100 years ago as a memorial to Cardinal Newman, who founded the Birmingham Oratory in the 1840s and who built the house which we still live in here, next to the church and also the school buildings and the cloister outside here. This church replaced the one that he himself built, because by the time of the beginning of the 20th century it was clear that the old church was no longer going to survive the ravages of time. And so the fathers here took the decision that they would make an appeal for funds to build a much larger and more elaborate church than the one that Newman had built. And so they managed to acquire a wonderful collection of marbles and mosaics and paintings and sculpture to adorn this church. I say it was much larger, but in fact it's only slightly larger than the previous church, and the previous church was more or less dismantled from within when this one was built around the outside of it. One of the first things that you'll notice about it, of course, is that it's not in a style that's particularly familiar in England. It's not the usual kind of Gothic church that most people are familiar with from the Middle Ages or even from the Victorian era in which Cardinal Newman lived and worked. This church is built in the classical Roman style, and it recalls Cardinal Newman's own particular devotion to the church of the first millennium, especially the Church of the Fathers and the Church of the Martyrs of the persecutions under the Roman emperors before the time of Constantine. This church is very much in the Greco-Roman style that Newman himself loved so much. And you can see, in fact, from the whole style of the arcading, that it's built like a Roman basilica. If you go to Rome, for instance, and to visit the Church of St. Mary Major, you'll find exactly the same style of arcade there, and also the same style of apse with mosaics in, as there are here at the main high altar and at all the side altars too. St. Philip is particularly important to us because he is the founder of the original Roman oratory in the 16th century in Rome. And Cardinal Newman, when he became a Catholic in the 1840s, along with several of his companions, who were Anglican clergymen by and large, was looking around for the kind of vocation that he might be able to follow in the Catholic Church, which would keep him and his friends together, to work together for the good of the church in whatever way the bishops of the time thought most fitting. And Bishop Wiseman, later Cardinal Wiseman, was at that time the auxiliary bishop here in the Midlands, and therefore had a particular interest in the new converts. And he advised Father Newman, as he had by then become, to look at the Roman oratory as a possible model for a community life which he and his companions might choose to live as priests here in England. And so it was that Father Newman and his friends went and explored the Roman oratory and its life and were taken on as novices in the Roman oratory and then sent back to England as new oratorians. And within a very short space of time, in fact by 1851, the oratory was destined to come here to Edgbaston to a purpose-built house, which is the one that still stands here, and the church which preceded this one. And then a few years later, still more buildings were added when Father Newman founded a school at the request of some of his friends who were looking for somewhere to educate their sons in a way that was similar, perhaps, to their own upbringing as Anglicans at some of the more famous English public schools of the day. As far as the church that dates from Cardinal Newman's time is concerned, the only part that you can still visit now and see is that of St. Philip's Chapel, which is to be distinguished from St. Philip's Shrine. St. Philip's Chapel, in fact, is located over behind the Sacred Heart altar on that side of the church. And that is the chapel where the community here, the Oratorian fathers and brothers, still have our daily prayers each evening. It's also the place where Father Newman continued to celebrate Mass during his life. When he wasn't celebrating a public Mass in church, he frequently celebrated Mass there in St. Philip's Chapel on the altar, which you can still see there. And in his later years, when he was a cardinal, and of course very frail and elderly, he didn't celebrate public Masses in the church very often at all. But for High Mass on Sundays and feast days, it was his particular pleasure to sit at the door of St. Philip's Chapel, where he could, in relative comfort anyway, listen to the singing of the choir for High Mass. And it's a replica of the chapel in the Chiesa Nuova in Rome, where St. Philip Neri is buried. The effigy under the altar is a waxen image, but it does contain some of the relics of St. Philip. The actual body of St. Philip, of course, is buried under a similar altar in the Chiesa Nuova in Rome. Let's also now move down the side of the church, and as we come past the first of the confessionals, we see the altar of Saint Athanasius. Interestingly enough, this altar has also got a secondary devotion attached to it, because underneath the altar we have a complete body of a Roman martyr, one of the martyrs from the catacombs. The body of St. Valentine, which we have preserved under the altar of St. Athanasius, is a very interesting historical relic. The catacombs were being explored by archaeologists, led in fact by the Oratorians, particularly in the 19th century. And when Father Newman came back to England in 1848 to found the oratory here, Pope Pius IX, as a personal gift to Father Newman, gave him these relics and also gave Father Newman the permission to keep the feast of the saint on his own birthday, which is February the 21st, which ever since then we keep as the feast of Saint Valentine. That is the name of the martyr whose relics we have under the altar. I think it's probably worth pointing out at this stage, before there's any speculation at all, that the name Valentinus is a very popular one in ancient Rome, and there were indeed several martyrs of that name, and this isn't the famous one of February the 14th. This is an entirely separate one. Little is known about him beyond the fact that he was indeed a martyr, one of the many in the early centuries of Roman life, and of course a wonderful point of contact between England, between the English Oratory, Father Newman's congregation, and the Roman Church, the source from which Cardinal Newman sought his inspiration. And of course, the association with St. Athanasius is by no means accidental. St. Athanasius was one of the very greatest teachers of the early church, one of the great bishops, the Bishop of Alexandria, one of the great teachers of the faith, who defended the truth of Christ's divinity against the Arians, who were the great rationalists of the 5th century. And it was largely because of his defense, his very stout defense of orthodoxy, that St. Athanasius had to suffer greatly for the faith as a confessor. He lived, of course, beyond, long after the age of the martyrs of the early church, but he suffered no less than they did because of his devotion to Christ as God made man, and was exiled from his see in Alexandria many times, which is why, of course, Cardinal Newman had a great devotion to him as a great teacher of the Orthodox faith, and also, having suffered for the faith, wanted to associate him with Saint Valentine, whose relics lie under that altar in his chapel. You see also the very beautiful chapel and altar of Our Blessed Lady. This is the largest of the side altars in the church. That, of course, is entirely fitting and appropriate because the church as a whole is dedicated to the Immaculate Conception of Our Blessed Lady. And what is particularly fitting about that, of course, is that Cardinal Newman chose to dedicate the church to the Immaculate Mother of God before the definition of the dogma by Pope Pius IX. Returning once again to the church, you'll notice that after we've left the chapel of St. Athanasius, we come then to the Chapel of the Holy Souls, a very beautiful, almost life-size wooden crucifix, which is modelled on one from Limpias in Spain. You see a very lifelike form. It's very much an object of devotion here in church. Many of our people obviously like to come to pray, especially during this month of November, for the Holy Souls in Purgatory and to leave here mementos of their own beloved departed. And masses are offered here quite frequently, and especially, of course, on All Souls Day, November the 2nd. Moving on, we come to the Chapel of the English Martyrs. Very beautiful chapel. The painting over the altar showing St. John Fisher, the Cardinal Bishop of Rochester, who was executed by Henry VIII for his opposition to the king's divorce and his maintenance of papal supremacy against the king's decision to make himself the head of the Catholic Church in England, separating himself off from the Catholic Church. St. Thomas More also appears there, of course, the great Chancellor of England in the reign of Henry VIII, again put to death by the king for his opposition to the royal marriage. Next to that is the magnificent baptistry. Now, the baptistry is important because although at first sight you might think that this is a wonderful example of Baroque art, it's actually a very fine example of local craftsmanship. The font was actually designed and made by a local craftsman called Dunstan Powell, who worked here in Birmingham. And it's a very fine example of alabaster. Also, a lovely piece of engineering, the font cover, which looks, of course, enormously heavy, made of bronze, when surmounted by this beautiful figure of St. John the Baptist, which you can see. You might imagine it would take a dozen men to move it physically off the font, but in fact, it's beautifully cantilevered, so that even with your little finger, you can just move it aside, and there you're able to baptize without any inconvenience, without having caused yourself any strain or difficulty in the process. We move across to the other side of the church, and working our way up from the back, the first altar there is the altar of St. Patrick. You see St. Patrick there, dressed as a bishop over the altar. Patrick, of course, obviously patron saint of Ireland, and a testament, of course, to the great presence of the Irish in England throughout the 19th century and beyond. Also on this altar you see the icon of Our Lady of Perpetual Succor. Again, a great object of devotion from Rome. The Redemptorist Fathers in Rome have long kept this icon and encouraged devotion to Our Lady of Perpetual Help. Moving on again, we come to the Chapel of St. Joseph. And here, one of the most beautiful statues in the church, that of St. Joseph holding the child Jesus. Moving on beyond this, we have the chapel of St. Joachim and St. Anne. I say St. Joachim and St. Anne because it's actually St. Anne's chapel, and the picture shows St. Anne. But if you look above, you'll see that the mosaic that adorns the apse has both St. Joachim and St. Anne presenting Our Blessed Lady at the temple in Jerusalem, a feast which in fact we observe on this day, November the 21st, which is why the altar is especially lit up in celebration of this feast, which is commemorated in this mosaic. And that's probably a good opportunity as well to recall all the other beautiful mosaics which you see over the side altars in our church. St. Philip in Rome made a special rule when his new church was being built in the 16th century. He said that he wanted to have some depiction of Our Blessed Lady over each of the side altars in the church. The church itself, of course, is dedicated to Our Lady, as our own church is too. And so we, following that tradition, have made sure that the mosaics over each of the side altars record some special event in the life of Our Lady. This one, of course, the first in the series, the earliest event in Our Lady's life, which is known to us, of course, from ancient tradition. The Eastern churches observe this feast with a great deal of solemnity, and we too in the West have observed it in association with them for many centuries. Then moving on again, going on in chronological sequence, rather than, of course, in association with the altars themselves, the beautiful mosaic of the Annunciation, which is rather reminiscent of the famous painting by Filippo Lippi, the Florentine painter. And then on the other side of the church, a beautiful mosaic of the Visitation, set against a very beautiful Italianate Renaissance background. Then, of course, comes the deposition, the body of our Lord taken down from the cross and laid in his mother's bosom and ready for burial, appropriately enough, over the Holy Souls altar. And then finally, in many ways, perhaps one of the finest in the sequence, the descent of the Holy Spirit upon Our Lady and the Apostles on the day of Pentecost. And that, of course, over the altar of St. Athanasius, the great defender of the faith. But we haven't quite finished yet, because we also have the Sacred Heart altar. The Sacred Heart altar is interesting because the altar itself was one of those, there are a few in the church, which came from the original church, the old church that Cardinal Newman himself built. And the altar in the final chapel, which we've yet to visit, that is the altar of St. Charles Borromeo. This chapel, in fact, is quite interesting because it's one of the last parts of the general decor of the Oratory Church here, which is almost completely owed to the single artist who was most responsible for the early work of the Oratory Church in Birmingham. John Hungerford Pollen was a friend and associate of Cardinal Newman's in his Oxford days, and became a Catholic like him. And indeed, it was a long and fruitful association between Pollen, who was an artist and an architect, and Cardinal Newman. Pollen not only designed the original Oratory Church, and of course the Chapel of St. Philip, but also he designed the Newman University Church in St. Stephen's Green in Dublin. But here, of course, the memories are kept alive where obviously most of us, of course, where all of us live and work, and where most of the congregations who've known the fathers over the years still come to Mass. They can, as they walk into church, walk past the tablets that record the names of them, the fathers that they have known over the years, many of whom, of course, would have been baptized or married by these fathers, and so would have a very particular reason to recollect them with great affection and gratitude. As you look at these tablets, you can see there the names and the ages and dates of death of all the fathers of the oratory. Right in the center, of course, the largest and most important of them, the founder himself, Cardinal Newman. And on that tablet, you see inscribed the words that he himself chose to be put on this memorial tablet in this very place. Ex umbris et imaginibus in veritatem, from shadows and images into the truth. Thereby, of course, the cardinal proclaimed his faith in the passage from this life to God that the soul takes after death. Of course, a passage which he imaginatively recorded in his beautiful poem, The Dream of Gerontius. Of course, the fathers, including Father Newman, Cardinal Newman, are not buried here in the church. They're buried at our community cemetery, which is some miles away, just on the edge of the countryside at Rednall, a very beautiful and quiet spot where the fathers can still go to have our retreats, whether spiritual retreats or just days of tranquility and recollection. And eventually, of course, when the fathers die, each of us is taken out there to be buried along with our founder, Cardinal Newman.